tuning into Liberty Under Attack Radio, your home for libertarianism in action. We provide you with real free market solutions using the freedom umbrella of direct action to give you the tools necessary to increase your own personal liberty. As Ludwig von Mises said, liberty is always freedom from the government. And now your host, Shane.
Good evening and welcome to Liberty Under Attack Radio here on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network, that is fprnradio.com. LUA Radio is your home for the peaceful philosophy of voluntarism. Not only do we provide you with the information necessary in understanding and utilizing this ideology, but we also give you the proper tools to create the freedom you desire in your life by way of the freedom umbrella of direct action. Today is February 21st, 2016. I'm your host, Shane. The website is libertyunderattack.com. I apologize for that late start there. Skype was giving us issues, which has been kind of the normal case. I definitely do apologize for that, but here we are. And with me are my co-hosts, Stan and Danny. Good evening, gentlemen. It's a pleasure as always. How are we doing?
I'm doing fantastic. I've been drinking since about 3 o'clock and just celebrated my 30th birthday, which was actually on Tuesday, but I had a pretty good show up. A lot of drunk people at the nightclub. May have taken a girl home that I did not intend to do. But, you know, good things happen to those who pray and, you know, have patience.
Indeed. Just make sure to bring food down for her later. Take some food down to the basement for her. So.
No, I kicked her out at 6 in the morning.
Oh.
Nice. Stan, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing pretty good. Just enjoying this weekend before I have to go back to the long grind of the week.
Yeah, I know what you mean. All right, well, Liberty Under Attack is covered by a BIPCOT no government license, which allows reuse by anyone except for governments or their agents. Learn more at BIPCOT.org. So there's one quick update I want to provide before I move forward. I'm going to skip the donate stuff, as you guys all know what that shit is. So there's one quick update I want to provide before I move forward, and that is the Political Prisoners Archive. I've spent a lot of time on the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom Archive. Yes, it's contradictory, I know, but that's the name of the organization. Dwight and Stephen Hammond's archive, along with Clive and Bundy, and the new cases brought up in regards to the 2014 Bundy standoff. Clive and Ammon and Ryan Bundy, Peter Santilli and Ryan Payne were all brought up on 9 charges in relation to said standoff. And all of those documents are available through this link, tinyurl.com/politicalprisonerslinks. So definitely go check that out if you're interested in looking at those court documents. With that said, let's get on with it. Tonight's broadcast will be the 7th edition of the Direct Action Series. Unlike the political means, which requires subjugation before those who claim to be our rulers, the economic means provide you with the ability to take the initiative yourself in creating the freedom you so desire in your life. That being said, the 3 topics up for discussion tonight are agorism, spirituality, and culture jamming, 3 items on the freedom umbrella of direct action. To help us gain a better understanding of agorism and spirituality, we'll be joined by Derek Bros from the Conscious Resistance for the first hour. In the 3rd segment, we'll be joined by guitarist Derek Caperton to discuss his 2 bands, King Conquer and WVRM. Derek's band, King Conquer, released a fantastic album titled 1776, which covers a number of issues we discuss on this broadcast. That is a form of culture jamming, another item on the FUTA, and it is definitely necessary. And in the final segment, we'll be joined again by Kyle Reardon to provide an addendum to the first time we had him on last year in regards to Dragnet wiretapping. So that being said, Mr. Derek Rose, welcome back to Liberty Under Attack Radio, sir. It's a pleasure to have you with us. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, man. Thanks for having me on, guys.
Not a problem. So just to start off, could you provide a brief introduction of who you are, what you do, and where the listeners can find your work?
Sure, thank you. So I'm a human being, activist, journalist. I wear a few different hats, but most of the time I play the role of journalist and activist. You can find the majority of my work through theconsciousresistance.com. I started the Conscious Resistance Network November 2013 after I came back from hosting Adam Kokesh's show, AVTM Live, and focus on journalism. I focus on, you know, a lot of the tools that you talk about. I definitely appreciate the freedom umbrella idea and getting people those tools, you know, direct action is definitely the way to go. My work focuses a lot on, you know, the journalist aspect is trying to get people to look at a variety of issues that are ignored by the corporate media. So education, and I think education is a big part of this, you know, probably a part of the freedom umbrella as well. I also am a journalist with a specific goal of propagandizing people to let go of government. So, I mean, that's kind of my end game with why I do everything I do as far as journalism. I try to get people to recognize the crimes and corruption that exist both within the corporate and the governmental worlds and the nature of the state itself, and hopefully push them to challenge those systems. And then whenever they come to me and say, but what else can I do other than vote? Then I try to push them towards agorism and, you know, getting into real solutions. So, you know, I'm definitely a really action, hands-on oriented activist in person. I've got some goals and visions the next couple years to put agorism and the ideas of freedom cells and other direct action ideas into practice, you know, to move from theory to practice using urban lots, reclaiming lots in Houston, getting to land, homesteading. So lots of different things. You know, I guess tonight we're probably going to talk more about the spiritual side of my work and, you know, how that all relates. But that's the short version of who I am and what I do.
Okay, very good, very good. So let's talk about agorism, and we're kind of repeating history here since we had you on one other time last year, but I'd like to kind of go a lot more in depth than what we did then, and obviously for our new listeners, if they aren't unaware of it, I want to be able to give them a foundation to work from. So producer, please put up image one on the live stream if you could, and this is a chart of the five markets, and you guys. So what is agorism?
So the way that I define it, it's funny that you're the second person today to ask me this question, which is a good thing. I was out earlier today in Houston checking out a farmer's market, and I ran into a friend who's come to some of the activist things I host, and he sees me posting on Facebook, and he's a nice older gentleman who is there vending his knives and sharpening knives, offering the service, and he's like, what is this agorism thing I always hear you posting and talking about? And it gave me a really great opportunity to show him it in action and to say, well, look, right here, you're providing a service. Did you ask for a license to do this? Did you pay any taxes in the process of doing this? No. Well, then you right now are participating in the gray market, which is a part of the Agora. And I think many people come to realize that they are actually already practicing counter-economists and agorists through their actions without realizing it. But essentially, it is libertarianism, the philosophy of libertarianism that your show listeners are already familiar with, taken to its most consistent application, to the fullest extent, which is living in line with your principles. You know, if you don't support the state, or if you have issues with the way the government runs, or the corporations, or the food production systems, or health, or media, or education, or whatever, well, the idea then is, instead of expecting those institutions to answer to the people through voting or through violence or other means, that we choose to create new means, you know, new systems of interaction, new methods of food production, new economic exchanges. And so Samuel Konkin really tried to outline the idea of using this strategy of creating agoras, the Greek word for the marketplace, and creating little pockets of agoras around the country and around the world, and basically establishing these as the state's power starts to, you know, collapse under its own weight. We can be ahead of the game. We can be proactive rather than reactive, and start to set up alternative means of exchange, whether through Bitcoin, silver, et cetera, seeds, just alternative means of exchanging in general. But also, I like to take the idea of agorism and apply it outside of just the economic means, because I feel like some people get stuck in there. And again, as a journalist, to me, I feel like my journalistic work is just as much a part of the counter economy as, you know, dealing with Bitcoin, because I'm providing a service that takes people's knowledge outside of the state's accepted purview of knowledge, which is what agorism is really about, is you're focusing on the areas where the state doesn't want to go. And I guess you're looking at the image, or you just saw the image of the different markets. The gray and black market is where us agorists focus. We focus on the areas that the state either thinks is illegal or unsavory, or that it's just untaxed work. You know, I have a gardening business. I work with six other agorists in Houston, and we don't have licenses. We don't have any, you know, regulations. We don't pay taxes on it. We just have a website, and we work with other individuals, and we say, hey, we will build you a garden, or we will build you a greenhouse and do these services, and individuals contract with us. There's no third parties involved, and we make money that way. You know, we accept Bitcoin, we accept silver, barter, etc. So that alone is the first step to pulling the money out of the statist economy. But to me, the fullest extent of agorism then would be not only that you're not, you know, that you're doing exchanges that are untaxed, but if you're still dealing in the dollar, you're still kind of within their system. You know, you're still using the Federal Reserve system. So the fullest extent is when we can create enough of these pockets of these agoras that our, you know, our friends in our community don't have to go to the option, you know, the Federal Reserve note option. You know, I was just at the community garden right now, and a friend of mine asked me about this. He said, you know, have you gotten completely off? You know, how much of your income is still within their economy? And really, the largest block for me, and just as an example, is my rent. You know, I travel for journalism, and I pay for all my plane tickets using Bitcoin. You know, if I want to rent a car, I use cheap air for hotels. You know, for whatever, and I do it all with Bitcoin. So that's one area that I've removed out of that. I get a lot of my food from the community garden, and I go to locals' farmers markets. That's just cash, you know. So there's no, you know, there's no. At least I'm partially outside their system. But the fullest extent, what I'm working on is to be able to get things like rent. Like for example, I can't pay my rent right now in Bitcoin currently. I haven't found a landlord. I have a friend who said they'll rent their beach house to people for Bitcoin, but thus far, I haven't been able to find, you know, a landlord that's willing to accept Bitcoin yet. So that's kind of the biggest block. But other than that, you know, my income is I haven't filed or reported taxes in 5 years as far as the income tax goes. I don't use a bank at all. I don't have credit cards or any of that kind of thing. There's no government piece of paper out there anywhere that has any of my information that's accurate. I can say that. at least not anywhere I've lived in the last 5 years. And, you know, things like that. So generally to me, agorism is not only just this strategy, because that's what it is. It's a specific strategy to make, to take libertarianism to its, you know, most consistent end. And that is one means to do that. And also I think it's beautiful because it's a strategy that could be employed by even individuals who don't necessarily align with American libertarianism or anarcho-capitalism or voluntarism or whatever. You can be really, I think you could, you know, call yourself whatever label you want and still recognize the value of taking power out of the hands of the state and, you know, creating new means. So that's kind of my version of it.
Okay, very good. And kind of what you were just mentioning, obviously, agorism, there is risk involved with agorism. So I guess when I brought the subject up to some people, they've been quite apprehensive because it requires them to break the law. so what would you say to those people to, I guess, encourage or put things into perspective to try to begin practicing counter-economics consciously?
Okay, so yeah, and you make a good distinction by saying consciously, because I've done, we've talked about it as well, but there's a lot of unconscious agorists out there. You know, like I said, the family who goes and buys some food at the farmer's market, they're participating in the counter economy already. You know, they're at some level, but they may be doing so without any sort of principle or moral drive behind it. You know, they're just like, oh, I like the community gardens, I like farmer's markets, I get to come here and I don't have to have my food shipped from around the country. So many people are already practicing, are already in the agora, they're already practicing these ideals, they just may not realize it. So yeah, as far as risk involved, definitely we have to recognize that there is a risk in operating in the gray and black markets. I talked about my gardening business, for example. Every time that I go out and do a gardening job, I run the risk of some bureaucrat asking me if I have filed the proper paperwork to, you know, to be a businessman and to conduct business with third parties. I have personally decided that the risk versus the reward is worth, you know, any sort of possible trouble that I may get in. But each of us as individuals have to decide that. You know, I'm a single male, 31 years old with no children and not married. So I have a lot of freedom to myself and to my life. Not everybody is in that position to be able to, you know, to take those risks. So what I would say is to start small, investing in things like Bitcoin, getting into alternative currencies, silver, seeds, etc. Any other alternative form of currency that you can use outside the US dollar is a real simple step that you can do.